Hello, I'm Dale Nemec. I'm a gardener here at Swarthmore College in the Scott Arboretum. Today we're going to walk around and see some spring blooms and other plants that have interest at this time of year. So let us start here with a magnolia. This is Magnolia Yellowbird. It's a hybrid magnolia that's been cultivated over the years to produce more of a yellow flower than the standard whites and pinks that you see normally in early spring. The hybridizer started back in the 70s, taking advantage of the native magnolia, cucumber magnolia cuminata, that had a yellow tint to its flower. So they hybridized that and crossbred it with other magnolia species to produce yellow flowering magnolias. One advantage that came about that is that the flowers are produced later in the year, so most of them aren't susceptible to frost damage. Another advantage is that the yellows have a wide range of color to them, some from soft pale yellows to bright vibrant yellows, and even there's orangey yellows as well as golden yellows. This one in particular, Yellowbird, was developed in the 1980s, 81, up at the Brooklyn Botanical Garden. And it's more one of the taller ones. It can get up to close to 40 feet, and it's more of an upright growing one. You can see the flower petals, or sepals actually, that they're 3 to 4 inches long, and they have an upright position. We're looking here at Magnolia Goldfinch, and as I mentioned earlier, previously, some of them do get damaged by frost. So this one was actually blooming earlier than the previous one, but it started to open, and then a couple weeks ago we did have a severe frost, and this one actually got damaged. As you can see here, the buds never really opened up, but the tree will be fine. It's pushing out new growth, but it just, unfortunately, we lost the flowers on this, which happens occasionally, depends on the year. This hybrid actually is sort of middle range, gets up to 30, 35 feet, and has a more of an upright structure to it, as similar to the previous one. Here we're looking at Magnolia Olivia. You can see how bright and vibrant this yellow people is. I compared to some of the previous ones, which are lighter yellow, more mellow, lemony yellow, but this is a nice, brighter, vibrant yellow. Olivia is a one that doesn't grow quite as big as some of the other ones. It stays shorter, say below 30 feet, and it has more of an upright growing habit. You need to do your homework, just like with all the other plants that you choose. Research them, see what size they grow to, mature into, depending on the space you have at your garden or your home. That will help determine which one you can pick out, besides just the colors that you can choose from. And comparing the size of the actual tepals to the previous tree, you can see how much longer, taller these are. They're well over 4 inches tall, so that gives even a bigger display of color. This tree we're going to look at is a Magnolia Judy Zook. It's another medium-sized tree in stature. The petals, or the sepals, sorry, are a nice golden yellow, and even inside the bud, there's a purplish pink tint to it, so it adds some depth and variation to the color of the flower. This one was also introduced by the Brooklyn Botanical Garden and named after Judy Zook, who was the director of the Scott Arboretum during the 70s, and then she went on to go up to be the president of the Brooklyn Botanical Garden. An interesting item with this plant is a lot of the Judy Zook magnolias do have a slight fragrance to them. The other cultivars are hit and miss most of the time. Some of them might have them, but yeah, this one is a little bit more pronounced and just another feature that you can enjoy with these yellow flowering magnolias. And here we're going to compare the size of the tepals again. So Judy Zook is a little bit longer or very comparable to Olivia. And there you can see the difference between the first one, Yellow Bird. So the size varies from plant to plant and cultivar as well. I just showed you a small portion of the number of different cultivars that there are out there in the trade. In the trade, there's over 60 different cultivars of yellow flowering magnolias. Here at the Arboretum, we have up to 21 different cultivars now. So the hybridizers are always trying to improve and increase that number of plants. Here we have a flowering vine that's native to the southeast United States and all the way over to Texas. Gelsimium sempervirens margarita. You can see the intense yellow brightness of the flowers. A terrific added bonus is that the flowers are very fragrant. I guess that's why they call it false jasmine vine. It's can be found growing, like I said, all down through the southeastern portion of the United States. It can be used as a ground cover. But here, as you can see, it's been trained up on a trellis. It will need support. It's not a self-clinging vine. So we have some wires attached to the pillar here, and it's woven in through the wiring. It is semi-evergreen here. It's hardy to zone 7, so here we try to place it in a semi-protected area or spot. It would be great along a porch railing possibly because of the fragrance. You can enjoy the fragrance of the flowers. All parts of the plant are poisonous, so it's a good deterrent for deer. And the flowers, I don't see anything right now, but it is a good pollinator. The flowers attract a lot of insects. It's been flowering now for at least 2 weeks here in the end of April, and it will continue to flower for another several weeks. And even sporadically throughout the summer and into the fall, we will get to enjoy some more color out of this vine. Growing conditions for this, it can tolerate full sun, poor soil, so it's an adaptable plant. Here we are, we're looking at a relatively new Epimedium that we just got in. Epimedium washensiense, sandy claws. You can see the dramatic foliage, the coloration of the foliage, the maroon, then even the shape of the leaf is really striking. The edges are serrated, but thankfully they're not dangerous. They are soft, so no harm on that. There you can see the contrast of the creamy white flower with the yellow center of an epimedium flower. So there's the spurs that they call them of the flower petal. It's like the other epimediums, it's a tough plant. It can take dry shade as well as this filtered light or even more direct light here in this situation. But like the other ones, it is a tough plant. You can grow it in a lot of different soil conditions. What we do here at the Arboretum is we keep the plant, the old foliage up as long as possible through the winter so it provides winter interest. And then we cut it down early spring. And in this case, we just cut it down with a lawnmower. We raised the level of the mower up and just cut it, and that just helped us save considerable amount of time and instead of hand cutting all this down. So yeah, it's one of the newer cultivars out there that provides dramatic foliage plus flowers. And also what they've done with the newer cultivars is they've somehow got the flowers to be produced above the foliage. Some of the older cultivars the flowers were down below in amongst the foliage and eventually got lost. Epimedium sandy claws is a shorter growing one. It gets up maybe 14, 16, 18 inches in that range, and it is also a slower growing clumper, so it's going to take a little more time to fill in this area to form a nice massing ground cover. And here we have some phlox stolonifera, and it's Sherwood's purple. It's a native ground cover. You can see how it contrasts with the flowers of the epimedium, but it also contrasts really well with the shrub in the background. That's Fothergilla gardenia Suzanne. That's another new cultivar that we just got in recently. That's a native shrub. Now you can see the white bottle brush type of flower on it. It's known for a great fall color as well. Again, it thrives in a semi-shaded conditions. Here we're looking at a tree peony, Peony pseudophoso Kishu caprice. This was actually introduced fairly recently. In 1988, it came from Japan, and then in 1991, the American Peony Society registered it at that point. So you can see how much of a double flowering pink it is. And another interesting fact is that it's the earliest tree peony to bloom. At April 15th, they normally, this actually blooms. Another interesting thing is the size of the foliage of the leaves. They're pretty large for a tree peony. And so this is considered a pretty vigorous, strong growing peony, tree peony. The blossoms, the stems are usually are sturdy enough to hold up the flower. As you can see over here, this peony is already a good 4 feet tall. It's expected to grow another foot or so. So it's one of the taller blooming tree peonies around. Tree peonies really enjoy to have some filtered light conditions, especially some shade in the afternoons. Soil conditions, they prefer nice, moist soil conditions. Also, try to remember to get out and go down and visit the tree peonies and the peony collection down below the Sproul Clothier building. You're gonna enjoy the peonies blooms for at least the next month down there. And here's another epimedium. It's called Epimedium Pink Champagne. You can actually see the bright rosy raspberry centers, to the flower and the spurs turning, fading to a light pink. You can actually see the stems as a coloration as well. Again, another epimedium that emphasizes a different color modeling on the foliage. You can see the burgundy blotches on this foliage, makes it more interesting. This one gets up to be 18, 20 inches, and it's a spreader, so it fills in nicely and rather quickly in the garden. It's again, as most epimediums, it's a tough plant. It can handle dry shade. Don't forget to plan your garden from inside your house as well. Here, looking down on it, you can appreciate it from another angle. From here, you can frame your garden to make it an extension from inside your living space as well. Here we go, we're gonna look at Arisema ringens. It's cobra lily. It's not quite as showy as some of the other things we've been looking at, but I find it rather interesting. It's a jack in the pulpit from Japan, so it is related to our native jack in the pulpits that we do have here. What happens is it sends up a shoot, and on each shoot, two leaves emerge, and then each leaf has three leaflets on it. You can see that it's going to develop into a rather large perennial. with shiny, glossy foliage. It's going to portray itself as rather tropical, a tropical look to it. But what happens now is, in the inside, you can see how this has developed. Purple and white striped part of the flower, and this is the spathe. And if you look inside at the actual flowering part, that white part is called the spathe. It's a tough plant. It can tolerate wet, moist conditions. You can actually grow it in the case of a rain garden. And another interesting fact is it at some point it may go dormant late summer, early fall, and what you're going to have remaining is the seed pods from the flowering part. And so you'll have these red seeds on top that will add interest. Here we're looking at Epimedium domino. You can see it's a very abundantly flowering perennial. The flowers have the white spurs with a purplish center with a nice maroon purpley stem to them. And again, these are flowers that sit above the foliage, so you can really enjoy the flower shapes and colors of it. Another one with interesting shaped foliage has a little serration to the edge, but not much. And again, nice modeling coloring on the foliage. This is another newer cultivar bred for flower production. It's more of a clumper than a spreader, but it does have a good size to it. It's going to get up to 18 inches. And again, it's like the other Epimediums. It's a tough growing plant. It can take dense shade, dry conditions. Like all Epimediums, they are deer resistant. Even rabbits don't chew on them very often. So it's a good plant for those tough conditions. Here we're looking at a spring bulb, Fritillaria meleagris. It's in the lily family. So sometimes it's called checkered lily or guinea hen flower. As you can see, the markings on the outside of the petals, it's checkered, and also what a guinea hen fowl looks like similarly. So you get the bulb and sending up the slender stalk, the foliage. It can get up to 18, 24 inches tall. And in some cases, such as over here, you can see it actually seeding in. So if left undisturbed, we can hopefully get a mass of new bulbs coming up from a better display. They like it in a semi-shaded area. They can also tolerate some of the more moisture conditions, more so than some other bulbs can. So it's an ideal plant for a wooded, naturalized area. And as you can see, some of it, they actually come in a white form called Alba. That's a cultivar. Here we are at the West Circle Garden. It's comprised of mostly native perennials and spring ephemerals. So we're taking a look right now at a Uvularia grandiflora, which is the large flowered bellwort. As you can see, these plants get up at some point up to maybe 30 inches tall, and you're looking at close-up of the flowers, and these are pretty much done at this point, but there's still, on other plants, they're still sending out new flowers. So you'll see these pale yellow bell-shaped flowers drooping down off the foliage. And the emerging foliage is a lighter green than some of the other plants. It's a good perennial because it fills in bare spots. that maybe some of the spring ephemerals, when the spring ephemerals pass away, that helps to fill in the bare spots of those. It can tolerate drier conditions, so it helps in some of these situations where some of the spring ephemerals can't grow. These take its place. Next plant I want to point out is the tiarella or foam flower, Tiarella cordifolia. It's a has the white star-shaped flowers on its stalk, and it spreads by stolons. So it can turn into a really nice massing perennial ground cover. The tiarellas, the flowers can last 2 to 3 weeks. So that adds added interest. It also spreads, like I said, spreads by stolons. So it has a shallow root system. So it requires a little bit more moisture. It may dry out and look a little ragged during the summer months, but it does develop into a nice spring ground cover. Here we're looking at the maidenhair fern, Arboretum pedatum, right here. Its stalks are very distinct. You can see how dark and black they are. The foliage comes out in half circles, as you can see. It's a very lacy, delicate looking plant. It is fragile. If you brush up against it, you can damage it rather easily. Again, it's another perennial that likes it more on the moist side. Summer months, dry conditions, it can really crisp up the delicate foliage. Like I said, it prefers a lot of organic matter in the soil conditions. And it's a slow spreading fern. It's not a rampant spreader by any means. Here we're looking at one of the trilliums we have in this garden. It's the Trillium erectum, or red trillium, and also referred to as purple, and also to stinking Benjamin. That refers to the smell of the flower. Sometimes it reminds somebody of a rancid, rotting meat, which is good for the pollinators. That's what attracts some of the flies and pollinators to it. Trilliums really enjoy a organic material, soil, moisture. As you can see, it's three leaflets, three outer petals to the flower, and then even three petals to the flower itself. A lot of trilliums, for some reason, it's in reference and to threes, and a lot of flower plant parts are in threes as well. As the flowers fade, it develops into a fruit, and the fruit falls to the ground, and then that's when the ants come and other insects, specifically the ants, come and take the dried seeds and disperse them throughout the grounds, and that's how the trilliums actually spread throughout the grounds. Unfortunately, the flowers, the deer love the flowers, but they don't eat the foliage because the foliage has a toxin in it, so the deer leave the foliage alone, but yeah, they of course eat the best part. Here we're looking at this purple flower, Phacelia bipinnata fidelia. It's fernleaf phacelia. It's a biennial, and it's a native to the southeast United States. So the first year it sends up foliage, and then the second year it sends up these wonderful, delicate lavender flowers. So, meaning biennial, it has to reproduce. So it self-seeds around, and you can see a large colony of how it's grown together. It can handle different types of soil, which it's needed for self-sowing purposes, and attracts pollinators and butterflies, and it's a nice colored purple plant if you want something to self-seed in your garden, but be aware, it can take over. Here we're looking at Waltstenia phragnioides, barren strawberry. It's a shiny, almost evergreen leaf to it. It becomes a nice ground cover, And you can see the yellow flowers to it. The three leaflets remind you of strawberry foliage, hence the name strawberry. But then the barren strawberry, because it doesn't get any fruit on it, like any kind of strawberry plant would. So that's where that name comes from. Again, it likes nice organic, rich soil, moisture, but it can handle drier conditions, and it can spread quickly. Here we're looking at another trillium. It's grandiflorum, the great white trillium. You can see the variation in colors from this pink to this white. And again, it's a plant that the deer love. And here's a perennial. It's Pachyra aurea. It's a golden ragwort. You can see how these yellow flowers stand up erectly, and it's a garden thug, basically. When it's happy, you can see how much it takes over. But it's a good ground cover in a native situation, or even in an area that you don't want anything else to take over. It likes partial shade and can even tolerate some sun if it's kept moist enough. So it spreads easily and helps fill in the bare spots. All right, here we're looking at Virginia bluebells, Mertensia virginica. And you can see the blue flowers sticking up. They emerge pink and then just turn to this violet blue. It's an ephemeral. In a little while, the foliage and the flowers will die down to the ground and you will have a bare spot. So it's a good idea to plant a perennial, preferably, to take over the bare spot. And an interesting point about the foliage, when it emerges on the Mertensia, it's a real nice lavenderish green foliage in a cup-like shape form. So it's a really neat sign for the start of spring to see that foliage coming out. It looks good with so many other ephemerals, especially the yellows like a wood poppy, and even the Pachyra that we just looked at, Uvularia, the bellwort, it looks good combined with that. Foam flowers, it would be ideal with the foam flowers, as you can see here, and also ferns. Okay, here's a columbine or an aquilegia canadensis, and the cultivar name is Corbett. So you can see these dainty little yellow spur flowers. So it stays about this size, and it doesn't really seed around all that much, so it's not that long lived of a perennial. So maybe every 3 or 4 years you might have to buy some more in. It has the typical conditions. It can tolerate some dry conditions, and in the summer months, yeah, you can actually see it does look tend to be either die out or look rather tattered. Well, I'd just like to thank you, and hope you have a chance to come back out to the Scott Arboretum. The Arboretum is open daily from dawn to dusk, and I just hope you can come out and enjoy the plants throughout the rest of the season. Thank you.